Every one of us has the will to win. It's an instinct that's kept our species alive for millions of years. Why does coming out on top feel so great? And why does losing feel so bad? Across the world, humans constantly struggle to get ahead. The desire for success is deeply ingrained in us all. Our drive to share in victory and avoid defeat is one of the most extraordinary aspects of modern humans. But it's an instinct that emerged in a very different place and time. This is the East African savanna, the place where our distant ancestors became human. And here, 3 million years ago, the seeds of our super competitive nature were first sown. The owner of this skull was the brightest guy the savanna had ever seen. This is Australopithecus, the original ape man, and one of the first of our ancestors to walk upright. They were also the first to leave the shelter of the forests and venture out onto the savannah. In this harsh terrain, fighting for everything was the only way to survive. We have a surprising amount in common, and certainly would have shared the same basic instincts for survival, sex, and competition. They stood at a little under a meter and a half tall and roamed these vast open plains in small groups. This would have been a very dangerous world. Their competitive instincts had to develop if they were to survive. 3 million years later, these instincts to compete still exist in us all. And there's a simple reason. Our bodies are designed to give us a massive kick when we're winning. Whether it's getting a job, being top of the class, or winning an Olympic gold, our responses are the same the world over. When we're close to winning, our brain and body work in harmony to make sure victory is sweet. As soon as we realize the win is within our grasp, our focus gets sharper, our reflexes faster. We feel unbeatable. We're experiencing the first moments of victory. And when that victory is assured, we get the full reward. The chemical dopamine stimulates the pleasure center of our brain, creating a profound sense of well-being. Next, endorphins rush through our body, fighting exhaustion and making us feel euphoric. This is the body's natural high. Endorphins do one more remarkable thing. Even if the boxer has broken a rib, he'll barely feel a thing. Because endorphins block pain by stopping the sensation reaching our spinal cord and brain. But that's not all. there's more to winning than just the buzz. Adrenaline from the adrenal gland near the kidneys and testosterone flood through our bloodstream. They've already given us strength during the competition, and now they keep us alert and speed our recovery. We breathe more deeply and our heart rate increases, taking more oxygen-rich blood to our brains and muscles. Now we're primed and ready to take on the world again. So we've all been designed to make winning feel great. But our instincts have evolved to make sure that we choose our fights and don't compete the whole time.
We all like to win, but continually competing can be exhausting. It takes a lot of effort, a good deal of time, and risk. For our distant, ancient ancestors, losing a battle could be fatal.
So we instinctively pick our fights carefully, only choosing to compete when there is a strong chance of victory, and avoiding conflict when there isn't, improving our chances of success.
When we see a rival, we make a judgment about their potential. If they seem stronger, bigger, or faster, we tend to move aside and don't try to compete with them.
Of course, we all want to be on top, but we instinctively sense when to fight and when to stand back.
If you think about the times when you feel most competitive, it's usually with the people you feel are on the same level as yourself, like your colleagues, your neighbours, or your friends.
It's a behaviour that evolved so our ancestors would avoid unnecessary conflict. But to do this, they needed a way to display their status, and modern humans still use the same signals. Those signals appear in our faces. We tend to regard some male faces as being more dominant than others. They tend to have prominent brow ridges and bigger jaws, becoming deeper and wider. Whereas a less dominant face is subtly different. The face is rounder with a smaller, less prominent jaw and chin. The forehead is more vertical. Altogether, more like a child's. And the features which make for a dominant face are no coincidence. Prominent brows and a bigger jaw are linked to high levels of the male hormone testosterone. And in adult men, testosterone is linked to physical prowess. So dominant faces send an ancient signal of physical fitness. And it takes just a fraction of a second for us to make a judgment about a face. In that split second, we work out not only if we recognize it, but we also determine how dominant it is. So can a winning face make a difference? Researchers studied cadets from the class of 1950 at the elite American military academy, West Point. They rated their faces for dominance. One of the cadets was Wallace H. Nutting. He went on to fight in both Korea and Vietnam. Today he is retired after 35 years of service. He rose to become a four-star general, one of the highest ranks in the US Army. Back in 1950, his face was rated as one of the most dominant of his year. So does he think his face had anything to do with his success?
I suppose facial features have a lot to do with it, because when we meet one another for the first time, certainly we evaluate, we make some snap judgments based on how a person looks.
Remarkably, almost all the graduates of 1950 who went on to become four-star generals also rated very highly in facial dominance. But even though strong faces appeared to have an influence, the scientists acknowledge that performance has the crucial part to play.
Ultimately, I would not think one might be damned in the profession because he didn't have a big jaw or prominent brows or whatever. But it's not the be-all, end-all. But undoubtedly, it can be a help.
But we don't just respond instinctively to faces. We also make snap judgments about people by the way they act. Meet Todd. Now meet Todd again. He's an actor. He's here to help us with an experiment. How does the way we present ourselves influence the behavior of others? Todd and an unsuspecting student have been invited to play a simple game of chance for money. They will bet against each other, and what they win, they'll keep. Before they begin the game, each of them fills up a form, a chance for the opponent to size Todd up. First, Todd acts like a winner. He sits in a way that suggests that he's confident and in control. He quickly finishes his form.
So, are you done?
Unnerving his opponent.
Should I get her? Are you done?
What?
Should I get her?
Should I get her?
Are you... yeah. Oh, I'm sorry. No, I'm sorry.
Now they go head to head in a card game of total chance. The highest card drawn wins. Will Todd's confident act influence the size of his opponent's bet? Even though it's a game with no skill whatsoever, a pattern soon emerges. None of Todd's opponents fancy their chances against a man who acts like a winner and place the minimum bet possible. They don't want to risk losing. But what will happen if Todd behaves very differently? He's no longer self-confident. Along with his shirt and hairstyle, he's changed the way he behaves. This time, he acts in a submissive manner. He sits in a hunched and unthreatening way. He avoids eye contact. He does everything to make his new opponents feel superior. Back to the card game. Now things are very different. His opponents take a far bigger gamble. Even though Todd can't actually affect the cards, his opponents act like they're betting against a loser. One person even bets the house limit. Amazing though it may seem, it appears that our judgments about who we take on are made more on instinct than on logic. We're all adept at sizing up the opposition, but it's just one weapon in our competitive armory. Whenever members of the same species compete, then any natural advantage will help to put one of them ahead. If it's a significant advantage, then it's more likely to be passed on to the next generation. It's rather like sword fighting. At the end of the 16th century, there was a revolution in the art of fencing. A parry was introduced. The parry was a devastating new move. It was a way of deflecting an opponent's thrust. And if you could do it, you'd come out on top. Those that hadn't learned to parry were at a massive disadvantage. They were almost certain to die at the hands of those who had learned this new technique. For our distant ancestors, a key advantage was having a competitive instinct. It was essential for survival. As a result, it became embedded in us all. And it's not just adults who benefit from these competitive instincts. They can reveal themselves at a very early age. We fight for our own interests before we've even taken our first breath. This is Kerry Huntrods. She's 36 weeks pregnant. And like any mother-to-be, she imagined that her pregnancy would be a harmonious time.
You have a real picture of blooming mum and, you know, mum and baby in harmony and, the, you know, the mum's body growing in this really lovely, natural way.
Everything appeared to be going fine until a visit to the midwife.
She'll be very difficult, I'm sure.
I went to this routine antenatal appointment and had a little chat with the midwife, and we sort of talked about what I was thinking about for the birth and things like that. And then she took my blood pressure. It was like just sky high, and I was horrified. I was like, I can't believe it, what do you mean? And she sort of explained, well, you know, you've got, I think, pregnancy high blood pressure.
Kerry didn't know it, but her body was competing with her unborn child. A competition that's fought out in every pregnancy. But in Kerry's case, her baby was in danger of causing her real harm.
You don't expect to have a tiny little baby that's doing something to you that's actually negative and detrimental to, you know, my health. And I suppose I found it really hard to get to grips with the fact that that was possible, because I sort of assume it's the other way around, that, you know, will I influence the baby?
At this late stage of every pregnancy, mother and baby are striving for different things. The theory is the mother's body is ready to give birth. She starts to withdraw food from the baby by lowering her blood pressure. But the baby doesn't want to be born yet. The longer it spends in the womb being fed, the longer it delays the challenges of the outside world. So it forces up the mother's blood pressure to get more food. In rare cases, the baby is too successful for its own good. The conflict gets out of control, and the mother's blood pressure rises dramatically, which can be fatal for them both.
I'm suddenly thinking, is the baby okay? You know, the baby's given me high blood pressure, and am I now not feeding it properly? Is it all right?
Fortunately, Kerry's condition was diagnosed promptly, and 2 weeks later she gave birth to a healthy baby girl, Rosa. Life's a battle from the nursery onwards, and we instinctively deploy any advantage we have to compete. And that's not just us. Take a look at these piglets.
These little chaps were born just a few weeks ago, but even to reach this tender young age, they've had to struggle. When just a few hours old, they were weak and vulnerable. For a piglet, it's the time when mortality is greatest. And in order to survive, they needed to eat as soon as possible to pile on the pounds.
With up to a dozen brothers and sisters in a litter, all these pigs have to throw their weight around to get the nourishment they need. And that means getting the best teat.
Research has shown that with pigs, not all teats are equal. Some are more equal than others. And in general, the best milk comes from the teat nearest the mother's head.
Let's put their competitive instincts to the test. Do the heaviest pigs win the best teats? I can only find out by weighing them. But first, I've got to catch them. Now I've rounded them up, I'll weigh each one and label them.
4.5 kilos, 4.5.
So, to the test. Will the heaviest of the litter force their way to the best teats near the mother's head? Yes, they do. The heaviest piglets, weighing up to 5 kilos, are feeding from the best teats, while the weaker piglets, weighing as little as 2 kilos, are down near the tail.
Almost from birth, piglets lay claim to the best teat, and once they've claimed their teat, there's no moving them. So in general, the big pig at the best position gets bigger, whilst the little pig, shoved to the tail end, remains smaller.
From the start, youngsters across the animal world use what they have to get their own way. And we are no different. Younger children in a family can't rely on muscle to get their own way, but they instinctively know just what to do to win their parents' attention. In this experiment at the University of Michigan, the mother's been asked to play with only the oldest child.
This man driving a fire truck.
This immediately brings out the competitive instincts in the younger children as they try to win mum's attention.
Look at this truck there with all those blocks in it.
Cannon, you don't want to shoot the cannon? Huh? Gonna
see what's their first approach is simply to disrupt their elder sibling's game.
You know what, we're not going to take this now. How about you play? Oh.
It's a powerful tactic that's hard to ignore. But in this experiment, that's just what mum's been instructed to do. And she continues playing with just her older child.
Over here, son.
Things for you to play with.
And even when the younger child is physically removed,
Look at this. Is a hammer for you?
It's not long before the lure of their parents' attention draws them back. So they compete with their older sibling once again.
Hi, honey.
They just won't give up. It's as if they are attached by invisible elastic. And if they're still ignored, then they unleash the most powerful weapon they have. The tantrum. The result, Mum's attention at last.
It's right.
Yeah, does that make you sad? I know that makes you sad.
By contrast, the older child uses different tactics.
Oh, thank you.
They don't behave badly. In fact, they do quite the opposite.
Yeah?
I love you.
Oh, I love you too, buddy. All right. Well, you're just waiting. You can, well, play with. Why don't you play something? Look at that.
Experiments like this have shown the eldest child is much more likely to play by the rules.
I love you too, buddy.
While the younger brother or sister is much more likely to appear rebellious.
You can play right.
And this pattern can be seen in younger children worldwide. And the behaviour we instinctively employ as children can stay with us for life.
Martin Luther King, American civil rights leader. Mahatma Gandhi, Indian independence leader. Charles Darwin, who dared to suggest we're descended from apes. Florence Nightingale, who pioneered nursing. And Thomas Jefferson, who wrote the American Declaration of Independence. What did all these people have in common? Well, in their time, they were all mold breakers. They rejected the conventional thinking of their day, and they dared to be different. They all shared something else. Not one was a firstborn. Each had at least one elder brother or sister.
A study of 120,000 people came up with a dramatic conclusion that the instinctive behavior adopted by younger children to get noticed can stay with them for life. They are much more likely to be radical thinkers and challenge convention. We're compelled to fight our corner from childhood. What drives us on is the chemical reward our body gives us when we win. And no matter how much success we achieve, we can't help striving for more.
Thought that happiness is a lifetime spent on a tropical beach with cocktails in hand. Well, if so, think again.
Because we've evolved a body that gives us a powerful reward every time we compete and win, we keep on striving for more.
Evidence is now emerging that there's an even stronger instinct which pushes us ever upwards.
One of the most potent motivations we possess, the fear of failure.
Sure, losing feels bad, and not without good reason,
the results can be disastrous. But it's more than that. Losing is a far more enduring and powerful experience than the rewards of winning can ever be. Failure feels terrible. And to understand why, we need to look inside our own bodies. Losing is overwhelming. When we begin to lose, our reward machinery is switched off. Feel-good chemicals, like dopamine and endorphins that have kept us going during the fight, begin to ebb away. We enter a downward spiral that makes losing almost a certainty. Suddenly, we feel every ounce of our exhaustion, every single muscle ache, every bit of pain, unlike the victor. We realize we've lost. And this triggers a release of the stress hormone cortisol. When mixed with the adrenaline already coursing through our bloodstream, we feel anxious, even frightened. And if the loss is catastrophic, a primitive response we share with reptiles kicks in. We become immobilized. The body's non-essential functions shut down in order to protect the brain. The vagus nerve slows our heart suddenly. Blood flows out of the gut. We get that sinking feeling in the pit of the stomach. Our muscles slacken. We lose control of our limbs. But the body has one final way to teach us a lesson. Every time we lose, the hippocampus in the brain is stimulated, making sure we will remember the loss forever. And the center of our emotions, the amygdala, fuses that memory to a profound sense of misery. This all creates a powerful reminder of failure to put us off making the same mistake again. This instinctive fear of failure means humans will go to extraordinary lengths to avoid losing.
You are sick to your stomach. Physically sick in the toilet on two occasions. You're not sleeping, you wake up at night.
In 1995, Nick Leeson was one of the biggest losers on the planet. He had lost his reputation, his freedom, and more than £800 million. He was experiencing the agony of losing, but on a scale few of us can even begin to imagine. But until that moment, Nick Leeson had known nothing but triumph. He was celebrated throughout Asia as the financial trader with a golden touch.
That was where I set my stall. You know, it was always to be better than the people who were around me.
To cover an initial loss, a relatively trivial £10,000, Nick Leeson started, unauthorized, to gamble with his bank's money. But the gambles failed. And as the debts mounted, the risks he took became increasingly extreme.
As the losses increased, and they would increase daily, I would take bigger and bigger risks to try and get it back.
For Nick Leeson, instinct took over from logic as he desperately attempted to avoid losing at all costs and evade detection.
You know, the walls are closing in effectively. Everything is spiraling out of control. Rationality was thrown out of the window.
But such huge, spiraling losses couldn't go undetected forever. His dealings broke Baring's bank.
You have this glut of emotions going through your body at that stage. It was an impossible time.
Looking back, Nick Leeson thinks his overriding motivation was not to lose face in front of those who knew him.
No, it's that fear of the loss of my reputation with the people who are close to me that drives what I did. I didn't want to go and expose myself to anybody. That fear was paramount.
In fact, we are all hardwired to avoid losing face.
Hi.
Losing face means we've slipped up, and we don't want to reveal that even to people we've never met before.
It's shaping up to be a great ball game here in Las Vegas tonight.
I'm a long way from home, passing a quiet evening at a Las Vegas ball game.
Oh, he's out of there. And that's a long walk back to the bench for him.
But often, we don't even need an audience to feel we're in the spotlight.
Oh, just look at that. Robert Winston has caught the whole can on himself.
Even amongst strangers, it's really embarrassing when you make a fool of yourself.
He's really not going to like that.
You feel the whole world is looking right at you. Of course, actually, nobody really gives a damn. But it's so acutely felt that it's very difficult to override this feeling.
That's because millions of years ago, when our instincts were formed, we lived in small groups. So everybody knew who we were. And our reputation with everyone was something that we needed to protect.
So instinctively, we don't want to lose face in front of anybody, even people we're most unlikely ever to see again.
You get a free shot. What's this thing? It's empty. What?
And we can capture our ancient instincts in action. How will unsuspecting shoppers react to a pile of cans we've rigged to collapse? Until that moment, the shoppers all around us are simply people we are unlikely to see again, and we don't pay them much attention. But the split second the pile collapses...
I didn't touch it. I didn't even touch it.
We care what mere passers-by think of us. Suddenly, our reputation is on the line. And we are keen to leap to its defense.
I didn't take from the bottom, I swear. Honestly, I was nowhere near.
It's a reminder of how important our reputation can be.
Sorry.
Millions of years ago on the African savannah, maintaining our reputation in a social group was a key to our survival. But keeping tabs on these relationships takes brain power. And where did that come from? Well, Australopithecus, the original ape man, was about to be trumped by one of our more recent ancestors.
This is Homo erectus. Just look at the difference.
Its brain capacity is twice the size, so it would certainly have been smarter.
It looks as if it has the ability to plan ahead and compete in a whole new way.
So what started this all off? What fueled the revolution that made this guy so smart? The answer appears to be a change in diet. More specifically, meat. Brains are hungry organs and require a lot of feeding. Roughly 20% of our total energy intake is used just to keep them going.
Millions of years ago on the savannah, a foraging diet of nuts, leaves and berries could never have produced such brain power.
The secret of our success appears to lie in the fact that at some point in our distant past, one of our more adventurous ancestors changed their diet and became the original meat and veg man.
Hi there.
This is Jobson.
Thanks very much. Cheers, mate.
In doing so, they not only fueled brain growth, but also set us on a route that catapulted our competitive instincts onto a whole new level. Big brains have a big advantage. It means we can intuitively put ourselves into someone else's shoes and then outwit them. It makes us smart competitors. We're all born with this ability, but it doesn't reveal itself until around the age of 3, as this experiment shows.
Do you like sweets?
Yeah.
I thought you might. I'll get some sweets out.
We're gonna play a hiding game. I'm gonna hide the sweetie in one of my hands, and you have to see if you can guess where it is, okay? Which hand is it in? Yay!
These children are being shown a simple game of hide the sweet.
Whoa! Which hand?
They all quickly understand the rules.
Yay! Well done!
Now it's the children's turn to hide the sweet. They divide into 2 groups. There are those that can do it,
this one.
The older ones.
That one.
Yay!
Oh, I got it! If you hide the sweet, so...
And those that just can't get it.
And I'll try and guess where it is. So you hide it up.
Before they are 3, these children are simply unable to imagine what their opponent can or can't see. So they are hopeless when playing this simple game of deception.
Yay!
Yay! That's it. Now, hide it up. Is it in? That one.
But as their brain develops, they too will acquire this new instinct for smart competition. Soon, they will be able to see into the mind of their opponent and hold their own in a battle of wits.
Yay! It's in that hand.
And a big brain allows us to do something else rather special. It makes us a much more formidable foe. Competition enters another level when members of the same species band together to take each other on.
Here in the Bahamas, you can have an encounter with a real rarity. Animals that gang up together in a very special way against their own kind. And they can teach us a thing or two about ourselves as well. They are dolphins.
Ooh.
with dolphins is an extraordinary experience, and they look as if they are just having fun. But much of this appealing behavior has more to do with cutthroat competition.
Synchronized swimming and surfacing behavior looks beautiful to us, but to another dolphin, it's a clear signal that there's a gang in town. Dolphins compete in teams. Usually two or three males band together to get what they want, females. This might even mean several gangs of dolphins working together to poach females from other groups.
And as these gangs have no family ties, each dolphin will only remain loyal if they're doing well and will change sides if they're not, making them highly effective competitors.
In the animal kingdom, forming alliances like these is rare.
In fact, apart from dolphins, there are very few species where this kind of behavior has been recognized. Amongst them are chimpanzees and, of course, humans.
Forming and reforming groups to compete is the final part of what makes humans such winners. From striving for the thrill of coming out on top, avoiding the agony of losing, to sensing when to pick a fight and when to hold back, we have a unique array of ancient competitive instincts. But it's our ability to band together, coupled with a bigger brain, which enabled us to become super competitors, the like of which the world has never seen.